chapter 13, 1 through 8. And I'm reading from the King James. And he went out of the temple. One of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he said upon the Mount of Olives, over against the temple, Peter and James and John asked him privately, Tell us, what shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answering them began to say, Take heed, lest any man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive men. And when you shall hear wars and rumors of wars, be not troubled, for such things must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, or different places, and there shall be famines, and troubles. These are the beginning of sorrows. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
The end of the world as we know it, and I feel fine. So we've got to start, we have to throw up. I don't know why it shifts. I don't know. I'm really bad at PowerPoint for some reason. I have no idea. But we have to shift away from a concept, and it is the idea that the church exists for like 100 to 300 years, disappears off the face of the earth, and then reappears. Sorry, I hate to ruin it. I don't want you to think I'm making up this concept. I read this book on it. It's called The Story of the Restoration. It told me what the restoration was about. I got real excited until I tried to figure out what the word meant. Like, I bet most of you have heard of the restoration, right? Those churches, Church of Christ, Disciples of Christ, Independent Christian Church, United Church of Christ, throw in a list. They're all restoration. And the restoration concept has a weird timeline which needs to shift down a little bit. And it's that somewhere around 300, the church completely disappears. It's the most depressing timeline I've ever seen, and it makes me want to cry. That's generally why it's a sad face. But then the real timeline looks a lot more like Mark 13. And it's this. You're going to hear wars and rumors of wars. And you're going to hear of all these things. And there's going to be earthquakes. And there's going to be all this terrible stuff. And people are going to look at the book of Revelation. A great book we like to misunderstand. And we're going to see all these things. And we're going to be like, this time it's ending. And if you look at this restoration concept, you're going to get a really depressing story. That we're waiting for this thing to happen. This end of the world, and we're just waiting for it, and when it comes, it'll be terrible. And the truth is, our history looks a lot more like this. That top line is what our history looks like. Because when the church first goes out, it goes out into all the world. How many of y'all know that Africa is now a Muslim country? We owned it first. How many of y'all know the Middle East is now Muslim? We owned that first too. How many of y'all know that we owned every piece of the world at some point? It was ours. And this is what the church looks like. This timeline of ups and downs and ups and downs. And what I want you to get today is not this terrible story of we're working till the demise of the church. And one day the church will go away. And it's so sad. And let's all be depressed about how the church is going away. The truth is, the church is like this. You hear of wars, and guess what happens? And the church fluctuates a little bit. We survive. We hear of earthquakes. earthquakes and famines and nastiness all over the world, and guess what? The church survives. And no matter what we deal with, and no matter what happens in the United States, no matter what happens in Russia, no matter what happens in the Middle East, no matter what happens in Africa, no matter what happens anywhere in the world, and all these rumors of everything, guess what? The church survives. The church survives throughout everything, and there is nothing that can come against the church, because Christ said, what couldn't overcome the church? Hell. Hell itself can't overcome the church. So as much as we would like to make this place a living hell, it will never be as bad as the real hell that can't even touch the church. So today is actually a very encouraging lesson, because guess what? We need to throw out our concepts of this super depressing history. And we need to get onto a history that looks like this, where the church comes back. You kill off Christians, guess what they do? Multiply. The greatest growth in the history of the church was right after Rome tried to kill all of us out, and then we took over Rome. Teach them. So today we are in Mark chapter 13. And we'll be starting in verse 9. But be on your guard. For they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations. And when they bring you to trial and deliver you over, do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say whatever is given you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. And the brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father's child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Don't worry, I read it in advance. I realize it sounds depressing at first. But what is it? It is our challenge. It says he has to go out to all the nations. And guess what it's going to do? Be terrible. There's going to be bad times. There's going to be problems. There's going to be beatings. There's going to be persecution. There's going to be people put to death. And through that, there is this endurance that we can develop, this endurance that says, you know what, through these different persecutions, the church becomes so strong, becomes so tough, that nothing it faces will ever conquer. Nothing we face will ever be able to be bad enough to overcome the church. Because we're left with this simple phrase. And it's going to be repeated throughout, and it's this idea of endure. Stay awake. Be ready. We win in the end. Let's continue. Mark 13, verse 14. But when you see the abomination of desolation standing where he ought not to be, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let the one who is on the housetop not go down, nor enter his house to take anything out. And let the one who is in the field not turn back to take his cloak. And alas, for women who are pregnant and for those who are nursing infants in those days, pray that it may not happen in winter. For in those days there will be such tribulation as has not been from the beginning of the creation that God created until now, and never will be. And if the Lord did not cut short the days, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect whom he chose, he shortened the days. And then if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, or look, there he is, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the elect. But be on guard. If I have told you all things beforehand. We know there will be problems, and that's the other one. We look at it and we say there's so much falsehood. There's so many people who want to introduce into the church something that wasn't there in the first century. Who wasn't in the first church, when the church was still developing, when the church was there, they want to inject all these things into it. And we say, well, that's how it will fall, right? our kingdom is from within. The best way to take out the Nazis was we were going to do what? Assassinate Hitler. We were going to use his own people against him, and we'll get him from the inside. And so that's what we look at the church, and we say, from the inside it could be destroyed. These false prophets, these false Christs, they'll perform signs, and they'll show themselves to be great, and that's what's going to take out the church. And he says this, he says, to lead astray, if possible, it's not. If it were possible, the whole point is to do the impossible. And what he's saying is, when the church is attacked, the impossible will be attempted by Satan. Satan will attempt the impossible. These false prophets, false teachers, false Christs are going to attempt the impossible. Because the church does not fall to hell, much less somebody who tries to mimic and create their own hell. And so we have this idea that even from within, when they're attacked from within and these false teachers come up, the church remains. We continue this idea in verse 24. But in those days after the tribulation, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be fallen from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. What we've done is they ask him two questions. And we always get this a little off. He asked them one question. When are these things going to happen? He said, the temple will be destroyed. It will be torn down completely. And they say, when's that going to happen? And he's describing it. He's saying there's wars, rumors of wars, all that. And then he comes to another section and he gives a little different picture. And this picture is the end of the world. Because there's a second part to their question. And when will the end be? And so in two questions, he gives this answer. He says, you know what? Watch this church that remains until when? When they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And they will gather his what? His elect. They don't fall away. Church doesn't fail. The church doesn't lose. It always wins. Until the end, when he comes back in his cloud of glory, he doesn't say he'll come back and then he'll be disappointed because the church fell away. It's not in Scripture. The church never falls away in Scripture. To believe that is to say the Bible's wrong. I believe the Bible because the Bible's wrong. Wouldn't make sense. But to say that the church never fell away is to commend Scripture and say, you know what? This has been promised. That the church will never fall away. The church, the elect, will always exist to the end of time, and there is nothing, nothing that will come against the church that will overcome it, because in the end he comes and the church is still there. So he tells him the story of a fig tree, verse 28. From the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near in the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven or the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man who goes on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning, lest he should come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all. Stay awake. He says it over and over, stay awake. He says this, not in the sense that we should never sleep. I like that answer, but it doesn't work very well. You try to stay awake for long enough, you die. But he challenges us to stay awake as to stay alert, is to be ready, is to not be caught up in all this craziness and know that It ends well. It ends well. And no matter where we are in history, we know the timeline. We don't know where we are in that timeline. We don't know how long the timeline will last. We don't know any of these things. And Christ makes it very clear. God's the only one who knows this. The Father is the only one who knows. We may go on for another 3,000 years. Who knows? But the only thing that's guaranteed is that at no time in the future, in the past, will the church ever fail. We know that by the time he comes back, the church is still great enough that it will be standing. And when we talk of the church as in at a distance or at a building or, you know, the church that happens to be in North Beckley, we miss the picture of how great the church is. Because if you look at the history of the church, it's one of the most depressing, exciting stories of all time. They went all the way to as far as you could go in Asia and as far as you can go in Africa. Everything landlocked. They went everywhere. Mark, the guy who wrote the book, Mark went all over the world. Some like 4,000 miles he's recorded. It's one of the longest trips. Paul has this short little trip and we're like, he went everywhere. Paul went in the opposite, Mark went in the opposite direction. Covered the whole world, right? And then how do you think it felt the first time the Romans took over? They saw the Romans come in and they saw it. It's the end of the world because the Romans are coming in. Well, we won over the Romans. And then they see a world and it was taken over again. And we go, oh, okay. Well, we've fallen again. This time we've fallen to communism. And then we see America's slow decline of religion. And we go, oh, Christianity's falling again. And instead of learning the lesson and learning what we are to learn from this, because honestly, if you try to put a date on this, you're claiming to know more than the angels and Christ. I like the idea that I don't know as much as the angels, and I sure don't come close to knowing what Christ does. But he gave us plenty of information here. He gives us plenty to say, you know what? Today, I know the church won't fall. Tomorrow, I know the church won't fall. And so we can look at this history stuff, and we can look at this prediction, because it's weird, because they're all predictions, and they're all in the past. You have all these predictions, and so many of them are in the past. When we talk about the temple being destroyed, we're looking back. When we look at, you know, the things that are going to happen, these wars and rumors of wars, we know those happened. And they will continue. And there will continue to be earthquakes. And there will be continue to be all these struggles. And the greatest thing we can do is cling tighter to the church. Because if the church ever fails, forget this book. It's worthless. And the reason I say that if the church ever fails, this book is worthless, I'm not saying that the church is greater than the people it consists of. What I'm saying is this book is the only reason that we believe in the church not falling. Because when I read a book like that, I get really angry. I'm sorry, I'm not a restoration fan now because I read a book. I should quit reading books. Because when it tells you something like the church fell away, I then look at it and say, so Christ is a liar, right? Because, you know, I read the Bible and I'd always thought this, and Christ came to give us a book to teach us how to live. Well, I didn't find that in the Bible. It's funny because I was using the Bible to assume that the Bible established something, and I was just building upon the Bible with this mysterious religion. But then I got to looking at it a whole other way, and I began to look at it, and I say, what did Christ come to establish? He never says, I'm going to establish a book. This is not predicted in Scripture. Isn't that weird? The Bible's not predicted in Scripture again. A lot of circles in this game. But the truth is, it's never predicted in Scripture, because guess what's predicted in Scripture? The thing that doesn't fall. Because in a country like China, where the Bible's banned, does that mean the church is gone? No. Doesn't mean we fall. I mean, it doesn't mean we disappear, because guess what? Christ has already told us that he comes and he establishes his kingdom, his church. And we know that when he established his church, that was the thing that was so great and powerful. That was the thing that's going to overcome centuries and centuries. Because there was a time in human history where most people couldn't read. And the Bible was kept from them, and we go, oh, I guess the church disappeared. Well, if it did, then Christ failed. Game over. I have this little illustration for you, and it's really simple. It's this. The idea of the church, it has this really strong base of Christ. But what I tried to do is I tried to build it with no center. And then some of y'all get this. Some of y'all, you're an engineer, you'll really get this. So like, if you try to build something, right? And there's nothing in the middle, it doesn't. I'll show you, it's cool. Well, it was supposed to fall in the middle and then everything stays standing. Some of y'all play genie, you realize if you take out the middle, it just falls down. Truth is that if there's no middle, there's no church. And if you look at history wrong, you're going to get yourself depressed. And if you look at the reality of the church, you're going to find a whole other story. We've suffered under everybody. We've suffered on every continent. We have suffered under every tongue. We have suffered and suffered and suffered. And you know what's up with the church today? Still there. Some of you look back and you say the good old days when the church was stronger in the U.S. Okay. It was weaker in other places at that time. And now it's stronger in other places. And you have places exploding with the Scripture. Yeah, it's declining here, but you know what? The rest of the world, there's a lot of places where the Scripture's growing and people and the church is getting bigger. And if we look at our tiny little microcosm and say, we live in America. We only care about America. And the church is in America. Well, obviously it's going to look really weird. But if we look at the church as something that covers the world, we say, you know what? Right now in America, it's going down. Other places in the world, it's going up. All this political news has got me really excited about the Kremlin. I don't know if y'all know this guy. Russian history? I don't know. I'm dark, I get it. So this guy named Stalin, right? He drove out the church, and then he dies. It's an effective trait of people. He dies, and so guess what comes back? The church. These people come in, these people get established, and then they die. Wait a minute. These people try to crush the church through everything predicted here, and he says, stay awake, stay alert, stay awake, stay awake, stay awake. Keep on keeping on, because it comes back. And if there's 10 left, those 10 can become millions, but if there's 0 left, that's what would happen to the church if there were 0 left. There's 0, there's no one to carry on. And so every one of us are challenged to be that one who carries it on. Every one of us. Because when something bad happens here, you may be one of the only ones left. And if there's one, that's plenty to rebuild from. One is plenty to rebuild from, but 0 is not. Today we have an invitation, and the invitation is greater than we understand. It's something that every one of us who have ever responded to Christ realize it's greater than we understand. Because we become a part of that indestructible kingdom, that church. We become a part of the very body of Christ.
And that's the invitation, is to be a part of that body. The image of baptism is so beautiful because it's, he takes an old you and he raises you up a brand new you, and you have the Holy Spirit in you. You're part of the body of Christ. This beautiful image of being part of the church, and there's no one who shouldn't run to have that. We offer that same invitation today that they've offered for thousands of years. But we offer an invitation if you need prayers, because prayers of the church are powerful. Prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And we also offer the chance to submit your leadership here. If you need to respond to any of those, we ask you to come now as we stand, as we sing.